Africa. They integrated with us. You understand? So when you see that, you see Mexicans coming across, borders are something that are made by Europeans, too. I mean, people have to realize all these things. Then we get taken over as a colony in 1898 by the United States under false pretense when we were about to gain just our independence. You know, do people know that we're still a colony of the United States? Isn't that imperialism? You understand? And as far as wars, people who talk about this junk, Puerto Ricans are the first one at the front lines at war. They get our people to go fight all these wars. The first person to lose their life, as a matter of fact, if anybody doesn't know this, the first person to lose their life in this war on terrorism was a Boricua, a Puerto Rican, you know, straight from Puerto Rico. And I hope the lady said something, this is the last thing I'll say. The lady said something about living the American dream, and I agree with you, ma'am. You know, but like I said, it's all about and everybody. We all should unite because I see this is shenanigans, you know, and it's about justice. Thank you.
Yes, well, I think a point in there that is worth recognizing. I think there's still so many in the United States, there's so many Americans who don't recognize the relationship of Puerto Rico and the United States. But Puerto Ricans are United States citizens, and while the status of Puerto Rico is always an issue of contention in terms of many in Congress wanting to change the status and create statehood or create independence, the reality is that it is a part of this United States, and we have a rich history of individuals in the Puerto Rican community making great contributions. And as Hispanics, we work across Puerto Rican community, the Cuban American community, the Mexican American community, and while we're not a monolithic group, Central Americans, South Americans, there are common bonds that we have among us, including ties to language and culture, but everybody has, I think, a sense of pride when it comes to their ethnicity and some sense of identification with that. But ultimately, I think there's a very few that would somehow not understand or accept the fact that they embrace being Americans. And as Americans, I think recognizing the differences that we have among the demographics in this country is something that we've got to reconcile as we move forward. I think it's something we should celebrate. Again, everybody and every group brings a unique perspective and contributions, but it's the richness of this country, and I think that diversity is part of our strength.
Let's go to Karen on the Democrats line, calling from East Orange, New Jersey. Karen, good morning.
Good morning. How are you doing? I just wanted to say absolutely to La Raza, wonderful, excellent work that you do. I have to apologize for one of the previous callers. Just from her voice, she sounded like she was African-American. I'm also African-American. And I just have to say, once again, just wonderful work that you do, and also wonderful work that you do with other minority organizations. And my question to you, and I'll just make it really short, what will La Raza do to continue to ensure that Latinos, and I work very closely with that community, continue to have socioeconomic and political mobility in this country, despite the historical advancements that are being made, like Sotomayor, who will, God willing, be confirmed. And also, you know, we have an African-American president, and I constantly hear people say there's no more racism in America. And, you know, I have a friend right now who is, you know, locked out of a public residency program and, based on discrimination. So I, in the backdrop of all that, I constantly hear people say, you know, there's no more racism. So I see the wonderful, beautiful achievement, and she's overqualified for her position, Judge Sotomayor. And how do you keep that from overshadowing those communities that are still struggling, still, you know, hoping for equality in this country and to be considered Americans, and I put that in quotes because that socioeconomic and political mobility is not available.
It's a thoughtful question, and I understand, and I, you know, the NAACP is celebrating their 100th anniversary this year, and my good friend Ben Jealous, their president, was quoted recently as saying, you can't have a post-race America until we're really post-racial. And you can look at the, again, the advancements in electing President Barack Obama as president, having Sonia Sotomayor as judge. But the reality is, as the caller identified, you still have instances across the board of inequality. And I think there needs to be opportunities for folks to advance and to have access to information and knowledge in order to do that. And I think, you know, again, we have found that by working together with across communities of colors, the Asian Pacific American community, other communities, and working, quite frankly, we've done work in the past with the Heritage Foundation, with other, you know, establishment organizations, because we understand that we can leverage partnerships to really advance the greater good for everyone. And I think that's really important. But the reality is Ben Jealous mentioned this, the head of the NAACP, is that on the one hand, you know, you have Supreme Court Justice Sotomayor and President Barack Obama in these great positions or nominated for these great positions, Sonia Sotomayor. But, you know, just less than a week ago, you still had little African-American children being denied access to a swimming pool because there were some there who thought that they were afraid or fearful of what that could mean for the other children. I mean, there's still a lot of work to be done with perceptions. But the reality is there's still a lot of work to be done at the socioeconomic level to create advancements. And that's why the programs that we help to promote through a network of 300 community-based organizations across this country that serve individuals and families in the areas of education, early childhood education, teaching English, and also making sure access to health programs, all of that is so important. And I think we're going to continue to do that so that we can continue to open the door to the American dream for everyone.
Okay, our last call this morning. Actually, it looks like we are out of time. Let's head to the confirmation hearing of Judge Sotomayor. About to get underway.